We are reporting on mobile cross-platform testing. I'm Yusuke Tsutsumi, and I work at Zilla.
And I'm Shovik Roy Chaudhary. I'm a PhD candidate at Georgia Tech. Thanks for having us here. So basically, this is not just something that we think. This came up from the minds of all these people who were there at the roundtable talk, right?
Yeah, so when we first tackled this topic, we kind of wanted to have a problem statement to kind of consolidate our thoughts. Here's what we came up with. The number of platforms and devices are increasing, which also increased the area that needs coverage. So with that in mind, what can we do to help scale our testing across all of these new combinations? Excuse me.
So what are these combinations? Okay, so as we know, there are more than 40 different configurations for iOS devices, right? And around 18,000 or so different Android devices. And there are some Windows phones in the wild, which we don't know how many of them are there, but we would like to test on all these different devices, right? And that's the motivation.
Yeah, and we kind of tried to identify exactly what's different about a lot of these platforms, right? So for Android specifically, we're talking about vendor customizations. Everyone wants to retheme it. That causes issues. There's differences in the sensors that are being used in all these devices. They're all different. And screen size is also a big thing. Everyone has their own resolution that they think is perfect for everyone.
Yeah. So what are the kind of bugs that are out there, right? What are the cross-platform bugs? Well, there are general UI bugs where something doesn't look right on certain screen size. But there are also behavior issues where some functionality is broken on a particular device, right? But apart from that, what are the other things that people saw, right? We were going around discussing it, and mainly this thing came up, that on older phones or older generation phones or cheaper devices, right, what happens is, if this will go next. So there are memory issues, like you run out of memory. Then there are some cases where some libraries are not supported on lower resolution devices. So something somebody brought up was that they had this video library that they were using, and it would just crash or not support an older resolution device. And they did not know of this a priori, right? Then there are issues like battery issues, signals from carrier, Wi-Fi, and so on, right? But then there were also issues that came up which were really due to specialized hardware. Somebody was you mentioned that they had an app and it would crash whenever there was a phone which has a physical keyboard. When the keyboard came out, the application would crash, and they had no idea why, right? So that was something. And then in Android, at least, you have to handle the activity state, right? Whenever you load up a new app, your app goes in background, right? So if and this is very common on older devices, where your app might be, or your activity might be terminated because it runs out of memory, right? So when it comes up, you need to handle that thing as well. So this is something that which causes a lot of bugs.
So there's clearly a lot of issues that can happen and are only caught on the platform side. So what can we do to test all of these? Well, the consensus that we kind of reached is, realistically, you can't test all of them. Right? Testing tends to be an area where there's a lot of constrained resources, and the best thing you can do, just like all sorts of testing, is to focus on what really matters most. Here's some techniques that we thought about that could get some good coverage. First of all, once again, there's a lot of issues that arise from checking the differences between platforms, but a majority of the things that you'll run into are probably able to be caught on the unit test and emulator or sim level. You don't need to move all of your tests over to real devices, because you think that that's where all the bugs will be caught. On top of that, targeting is really important here. So an example here is, right, Shavik came up with the idea of low memory devices having a lot of issues. If your app is going to take up a lot of memory, have the highest, most intense test run on those. Target the platforms that are most likely to have the issues. On top of that, test the popular platforms, right? Most likely, your app is not going to have a 2% market share with over 50 different devices. Most of the time, there's going to be some big, really large market shares out there, right? Like the Nexuses or the Samsungs. With that in mind, just scale your testing in such a way for real devices where you tend to test on those more. That gets you a lot of coverage. With that in mind, you still want to keep a varied subset to kind of poke out there and see what other bugs exist. They don't have to be a lot, they just have to be varied. That way, when you find a regression in one of those particular areas, you can actually just expand on that.
Okay. So let's continue. So we said that there are a lot of devices out there, right? But who has these devices? Users, right? So can you get your consumers involved? And this is the idea where, you know, you have a pool of beta testers who have this varied set of devices, and they help you test these out, right? And beta testers, they, you know, users bring a fresh perspective to your app, and then they help you find bugs that you did not anticipate before, right? And there are a bunch of tools to recruit these, you know, users, right? And also what you want to do is you would want to use a cross-platform test framework. What it means is that you write your tests in one place, and it runs on all the different devices, right, or frameworks.
Yeah, I mean, that was the original question that we were going to tackle here is, are there cross-platform test frameworks out there? And I think we all know that they do exist, and they're actually pretty good, right? Appium is a great example of that. Everyone likes that whole Selenium protocol. There's a lot of other alternatives like Cucumber, Eggplant, Espresso, of course. Yeah, they're definitely out there. And another question that we thought about is, how do you deal with so many devices, and how do you find devices to test on? Well, all the people who are in this conversation agree that most likely you probably shouldn't buy those devices yourselves, right? Unless you're a company that's making billions of dollars and you're dedicating $50 million to mobile testing, it's probably not realistic. Take advantage of companies that are utilizing mobile or creating clouds of real devices already, like Hyperify yesterday. We brought up some other ones as well, Aftwack and Testroid. So there's definitely a lot of people in that area.
So in summary, even if you were sleeping for the whole time, basically, this is the what we covered during our discussion. So the first thing was you want to use a platform agnostic test framework. Then you know, you have to realize that you can't test every combination of all these devices and all features across all these devices, right? So you have to choose a subset which maximizes on your coverage, right? And then you can use your audience because they have a wide variety of, you know, real devices, right? And finally, you can also use or leverage test device clouds to keep up with the, you know, growing number of real devices. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have questions during the talks? Okay.
Solutions provided, which I believe these are like, the first thing, we don't have a platform agnostic test framework yet. This is something, if you have a test framework which works on Android, that wouldn't work on iOS. Because even if your application's screens remain the same on a iOS device, the launch activity things, other things, controlling the device part would totally change. So this part, I don't know, because I've been working on mobile automation like almost past 3.5 years. That's one thing. Subset of a thing, yeah, that wouldn't maximize your thing, but the real problems which comes on a lower end device, that will still remain, because that bugs and all, you get it at randomly from different users when they report to the customer care for your application. Using the audience, the problem would be if a user have a low-end phone, it's more likely that he doesn't have access to all the other sources where he can be a beta tester, because a very low-end phones doesn't support much of the internet things and all to be smart enough to download at least and do the testing on the phone itself, be a beta user. Like if you are that techie enough, obviously, like most likely, it's not like in every situation, but most likely, you'd be having a smartphone and you could participate in the beta programs. Like for an example, if your application is on a very low-end Nokia phone, you wouldn't have that, like Nokia 520 Lumia, or maybe less, you wouldn't have access to internet and all. Device cloud, what's the cost of device cloud? How much device anywhere charge for a particular, it's a per hour charged, right? It's maybe $30 per hour. If you're using a device for 8 hours a day, it's $240. And in $240, you get a device directly, buy the device once and own it for all. These things, device clouds is very much useful when you have this kind of rare issues on different devices or a random device. Then you can have like one license and at least use that device. So these are my thoughts which I am actually facing on having this in the past 3 years.
Sure, sure. We agree with that. So basically, this is what we came up with, the best practices, right? But this is going to be different in different contexts, right? So you have to yourself decide, what subset is good for your app, right? There's no golden number that you should test for all apps, right? So there is nothing like that. So you have to go through it, ask yourself. So another question was about device clouds, right? They're expensive. But another thing is that if you buy a device today, the life of the device is probably 2 years, and then what do you do after that, right? So here you are renting all the devices, right? So it, again, depends on your use case. If you want to go thorough on one particular device, then probably you can buy it, and otherwise if you just want to run across one test across different devices, perhaps device cloud is cheaper, right? Then another thing about your audience, right? So maybe the current solutions out there are not good enough to give you a variety of real devices, and that may be something that people can work on in future.
I actually have some specific replies too. So the platform agnostic test framework, you're definitely right. There's going to be actions that aren't necessarily cross-compatible between the two. And that's an unfortunate part. The kind of problem that we are tackling is how to scale the testing as best as possible, right? So the best that you can do right now with existing platforms is there's some actions that can be shared, right? So for example, Appium works as long as the naming of the elements on both iOS and Android are the same, you can actually perform a majority of the actions in the same way as well. So that's a caveat. You didn't find that?
Yeah, I got that. So that would be specifically to your test classes who would work on your particular test thing.
Okay, so you don't have control over that, is what you're saying.
Yeah, you have a control over that. But once you come to the platform test framework, that should be supporting both the platforms, not specific to your particular test cases on your application.
Well,
that is the problem.
That's unfortunate, right? If you don't have control over, if you're not able to talk to the people who wrote the app and tell them, please use the consistent naming, then you're right. That's unfortunate, and you're going to have to deal with that yourself. I think most of the time, though, as long as you have some collaboration with the teams who are actually authoring these apps, you probably won't run into as big as a problem there.
No. My thing was, it's not about controlling your application. That is controllable. That part is fine. But the platform test framework is not about your application. It is a test framework which should support the testing of single app on multiple things. So that controlling on different platforms of your application can be controlled. The UI of your application.
About actions external to the app itself.
Your app is controlled. That is controllable. Obviously, that is controllable.
Yeah, sure.
But
okay.
The other part. That is the main thing which is not controllable.
Well, sure, there's no framework we found. We agree with you. There's no framework we found that will actually help you control actions outside of your app in any significant way. Yep, definitely true there. I just wanted to comment on the device cloud really quick, and I know we're running out of time. Yes, it only costs maybe $240 to buy your device. But how much does it cost a human being to go over to your device, restart it every once in a while? And how long does it cost someone to develop time to actually run that automation, connect it, and make sure that it's going to auto-restart and do all the work that App Purify, for example, has worked on. That's the type of costs that end up overcoming anything beyond the actual hardware.
If you say device anywhere or Perfecto Mobile, they charge you for the hiring the device operations, but you write your own tests and run it over that thing. So the writing the test is still on your part, which device anywhere doesn't take care. They only provide you the devices on hire basis.
Oh, sure, of course. So
here, if you're charging $30 per hour for any device, okay, and you are using this, if you're doing a UI tests on Android, it wouldn't be so fast as you are running it on a PC or on a web browser. It would surely take time because the UI interactions, the device doesn't, it would take time. And then you'd be probably running your test like over 3-4 hours, 5 hours or something. So if you run it over a period of time, it would cost you the same as the device. So again, these licenses are yearly based. These are not like once you pay.
Okay, sure. So your company, right?
So yeah. I hate to interrupt this great discussion, but let's keep going. You guys can take it offline. Yeah. Thank you so much, Avik and Yusuke, for presenting. Takes a lot of courage to come up here and talk. Thank you.